हेलो वेलकम टू ईगल स्पोर्ट्स यूरो एंड कोपा अद्भुत निर्वहिस्ट सदर्भ चूस्त इकड़ मन तो माटा की वी हैव इंडियन फुटबॉल लेजेंड भजन बुडिया मन तो आयन तो माटा भजन थैंक यू सो मच फॉर डूइंग दिस विद अस एंड यूरो इफ यू लुक एट यूरो दिस इज द 60th ईयर एंड वी आर सीइंग यूरो बीइंग कंडक्टेड इन 11 डिफरेंट कंट्रीज सो दिस इज अ ह्यूज थिंग फॉर एनी फुटबॉल फैन.
Yeah, but I think it's the 60th year, that's why I think they're doing it in 11 countries. But I'm not a big fan of tournament like Euro, Copa, America and World Cup to be hosted by 11 different countries and cities, because this is once in 4 years and that country, whichever country hosts it, maybe one or two can always host it, not 11. It becomes a festival. You know, you have the entire country gets that festival mood. People from across the world comes to those two countries, or one single country who's hosting it. It becomes a very nice, beautiful atmosphere with a festival mood. But holding it in 11 cities, 11 countries, you don't get that charm. Just one or two matches and then, you know, you finish it.
Right.
You don't get that kind of charm.
So the euphoria is not big.
I'm not a big fan of at least 11 cities hosting this big tournament.
Right. Then again, let's talk about Euro in detail. Let's get to some statistics straight away. And we have seen a lot of penalties being missed. So what do you think? I mean, the goalkeepers are actually researching more on how the strikers will take the kick, or the strikers are giving it away when they're trying to take a go of the penalty shot. What is the reason, you
think? I don't think there's any particular reason. It's the phase. Sometimes you just go through bad phase of missing it. Even right now, penalties are more advantageous for the striker.
Absolutely.
Because the goalkeepers are not allowed to move out of their line before they could take a step forward and move, and that could cover a little bit of angle to it, you know. So right now the advantage is much more to the striker, but you'll have those phase anyway.
Right.
You'll come in, maybe after quarterfinals you might get into a penalty shootout. Nobody's going to miss. I think we saw a penalty in European Champions League or somewhere where at the end everybody took it, the goalkeepers had to take
right.
it, and the
right.
goalkeeper missed
correct.
It.
Correct.
So you have those moments also, you know, penalties going up to 12, 13 players taking shot for each and every team. So I think just the phase. It's good for the goalkeepers.
Right, so the goalkeepers are actually missing the penalty. One more thing that is surprising is from 1960 to 2016, all the 13-14 editions of Euro, they have seen only 9 own goals, and now we are seeing already 8 in the single edition. This is another surprise.
I think it's good to see, again data, but again, these are things you don't really say that any team did particularly
correct.
Different strategy or tactically. It's not just that, but I think we are seeing more goals. Obviously, is the style of play right now.
Right.
Definitely, own goals are also to do with the style of play with the teams are playing. So now, if you look at teams, they play more width. They open up. They have a lot of people running inside the box. They don't do like old generation of crossing coming high and in the air. So right now, you are when person going to the left and right hand side of the pitch, they're not doing the aerial crosses.
Mm-hmm.
They are doing all crosses which is between the goalkeeper and the defender, which is the most difficult to defend. And when those kind of crosses comes in, when there are a lot of counter attacks, then it's bound to be difficult for defenders. And in that situation, you do get a lot of own goals. So I think it's the strategy and style, because people are not going now. It's not like typical going to the wide and doing David Beckham crosses. Now is, making those quick moves and putting the ball across low drive inside the box between the goalkeeper and defender. And that's where you're getting a lot of own goals.
Right. And we have seen Italy, the team which was not qualified for the FIFA 18 World Cup. And then they have gone through such a turnaround. And they are not losing games. And they have won all 3 games continuously. And they're looking as favorites this time.
Yeah. Now, if anybody's followed Euro 2020 and followed our pre-match shows, from the day one, I've said, if you go back and see, because the first match was played by Italy and Turkey, and I said, this is the best team you should watch. I said,
right.
all the football fans, please don't miss Italy,
because
they are this time very different. I've been seeing them, following them. They play good, attractive football. Otherwise, they are a very defensive-oriented team. They win with strong defense. But this Italian side under Mancini, and the generation of players are very technically, tactically, and they are very creative as a player. So, when you have that kind of player, I think Mancini is playing to that strength, which is a very good sign for coach. You want to play good brand of football, you want to win, and you want to entertain people. because you've got those quality players. Before they didn't have that. They had great players, but they didn't have that kind of players which you have right now. So when you have certain kind of players, you play with a certain style. And this style of Italian game has been, I think, very, very entertaining, fun to watch. And it's so much fun watching them going attack, going front.
Right, right. That is something that we always wish to see, but we never saw. And again, one more team that we all have eyes on is Belgium. The way they have started playing, and then once De Bruyne came in and played full time, and Eden Hazard came in and played full time, now they are looking forced to reckon with. Before also they were very strong, and now they are looking even stronger.
Before, I feel they were a little more stronger 3-4 years ago, or maybe in the World Cup, because that time they had a complete strength in terms of defense.
Right.
They had Kompany, who retired, I think, who was a great defender and a great leader. So once his retirement, then there is slightly weakness in the defense. They are still a great team going up front. I think Lukaku can score goals if you can give him the ball. De Bruyne can create from anywhere. Eden Hazard is getting back to his fitness. So they are a great team in terms of going front. They will score goals. But I'm not too sure about how strong they are defensively. Because it's not as strong as when they were in World Cup.
Right.
So still it's one of the favorite teams to be there.
The reason I ask you is they're playing Portugal. And Portugal have this knack of scoring many goals in per match. The minimum they scored is 2 in all their league matches. So can we see Portugal actually putting pressure on Belgium defense?
I don't think so. I think, Portugal to really do anything great against Belgium might struggle because, again, Portugal defensively we've seen
right.
is again not too strong. They try and play with... I think they tried playing with 4, but the fullbacks are not coming back when they have to defend. Pepe is not in his best in terms of speed.
Right.
He's a great experienced defender, but he doesn't have that speed to now control it. And we saw how Germany exposed
right.
them before, through the wings. And when the back left side went up, there was nobody to track him down.
Right.
So defensively, we saw that Portugal is not as strong as any other good defensive team. So that way, I think they could get punished. Up front, I think they're still strong. They've still got quality there. But I think it may be very, very difficult for them.
And any views on Gareth Bale? Because he has provided assists, but he's not able to score goals in the 3 matches.
I think Gareth Bale is definitely not in his great form. It's nothing to do with his quality. He's a great player. But I think mentally, there are moments when players get tired. And everybody goes through that. I think he just needs a good break out of football for some time because he's got that quality. And I think right now you see he's just playing for the sake of playing and he's been forced to play either in club or country. I've seen him play for Tottenham towards the end when he was not happy with Real Madrid. Even there, you don't see him as a happy expressing player because when you saw him when he was playing in Tottenham initial days with Real Madrid, you could see a happy player who could run at people, who could run with that speed, who could cross, who could do acrobatic things to score goals. You could see the guy is having fun. And for the last 1 year with club in Tottenham and now with Wales, you don't see him as a happy player. And when
right.
you don't see a happy player, the performance doesn't come.
Right. And any dark horse to reckon with in this round of 16?
Denmark for sure. I think Denmark is going to be a good dark horse. They came from almost a dead situation, and they obviously played very, very well. But I think Denmark.
Absolutely. The first match, Christian Eriksen going out like that, collapsing, and then from them, for them to actually resurrect themselves and play a good game and win against Russia is definitely.
Yeah, I think that Eriksen game really distracted them quite a bit in terms of first match. And then had to come and play, which is a bit unfortunate. But I think if Eriksen incident didn't happen, they would have started from day one as
right.
a great team. But with that, I think they are a bit unlucky. But they have bounced back and as I said, they played all the 3 matches, very, very good quality matches. So
right.
now I think they can upset one or two big teams.
Right. Your final 4 teams?
I have not seen the chart
okay.
in the
right.
sense how it goes.
Goes to quarterfinals.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, because I have not
yeah.
seen that.
Yeah.
But I would say Belgium, Italy, France, and maybe Germany. I don't know about how they, which group they place and all that. So these are the 4 teams.
Now that you have got in Germany, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
England are playing Germany in round of 16.
Yeah.
So how is that match going to be? It's actually do or die for Southgate.
If England plays the way they have played in the last 3 games, they'll get beaten.
if England plays to their strength, which is creative football, they can upset Germany. Because England is a team that can play good creative football. They have players to do that. And if they don't play to their strength, I don't think they can defeat Germany. But right now, I don't feel Gareth Southgate is the right manager for England. They need a good manager who's willing to take risk, who's willing to play to the strength and play more creative football. Because they have the strength. And if they didn't have that players, then England would not have won Champions League, Europa League twice in a year.
Okay.
You know, you have those players. And those players play in good quality football. Look at Man City, Chelsea. They're all good creative team which plays good attacking football. And a lot of the players in these clubs are in the national team. So why is Gareth Southgate going defensively? He's played three games with three different 11. He doesn't know who's his first 11. He's still confused with right and left side back. He's still confused who to partner Gareth, Harry Kane.
Okay.
So he's in a confused state right now. So if they play the way they played, I don't think they're winning against Germany.
Criticism on Harry Kane?
I don't think Harry Kane you should criticize much. It's just because the coach is not playing to the strength. The coach has not got the right combination. Maybe he did not get time because the players were busy with the club tournament. He didn't get to see and get the team play together for a long time, because even his last two friendly matches he had to play completely second 11 team because the players were not back and they were on under rest. So I don't blame him as well, but I think Harry Kane is a great player, great striker. He's most probably going to Man City. He will again score plenty of goals, you'll see that. But with Gareth Southgate, I don't think he can get those results.
Netherlands and Spain, you know, Spain has started in a very dull way, you know, drawing two matches and then they've got a 5-0 win. Netherlands, on the other hand, have kept winning. So these two teams are also actually looking.
Spain does not have a genuine goal scorer. They lack big time. And that is the biggest, I think, problem with them. They scored 5 goals in the last game,
right.
But their main striker, Morata and Gerard Moreno, did not score. And they rely on this. When you're playing against a strong, good defensive backline, you need your strikers to score. And the two of them have not been firing. So I don't really see if Spain, if they go into the quarterfinal, from the pre-quarterfinal to quarterfinal, I think they will struggle in quarterfinal and semifinal.
Right. Netherlands?
Netherlands, again, is a good team. We've not spoken much about it, but I think right now, the way they've been playing is a good side. They are, again, one of the team. I could be wrong, could at least may go to even semi-finals to finals.
So they are in good form also.
They're in very good form. They're playing very well. They've done well. I think the team combination, they're playing to their strength.
Right.
So the way they've been combining as a team and developing that kind of understanding, I think it's been good.
Right. And then let's talk about individual milestones. Now, 109 Cristiano Ronaldo, he's the joint highest goal scorer internationally along with Alidei. This is a huge achievement for him because he has scored against Germany for the first time in Europe. He has played a lot of matches, but the first time he has scored against Germany, and now he has 109 with him.
No, I think you can't stop somebody like him from scoring, and he's again proved it. You know, he's going on scoring. I think even in Euro now, 5 goals, he's going to be the highest goal scorer. Obviously, it's going to be difficult with Belgium. They might not progress further, but I won't be surprised. He might score one goal and go to 6. But I think it's a great achievement. I think if you look at his fitness now as well, he's in his great form, shape. The way he sprinted for the first goal against Germany itself shows that he's still got the speed. I think I was thinking it's going to be his last Euro, but the way he's playing, it might not be his last Euro.
Right. And now, sir, this is Euro, but let's also talk about what India has done in the FIFA qualifiers. And India has beaten Bangladesh. They've drawn levels with Afghanistan, and then they've progressed to the Asian Cup qualifiers round 3. So what do you look at, and how do you look at Indian team performing?
I think Indian team performance has been mixed, but more of not a great thing to be proud of. Initially, they had a great match against Qatar, which they drew. And then they came up with, I think Kuwait, was it?
Oman,
which they lost 2-1. Till then, I think it was quite promising. But then again, when you go into matches where you have to win against Bangladesh, Afghanistan, then we couldn't see the creative side of it, more from the Indian side. And they drew with both the teams. And even last match against Afghanistan, they drew, which was more shocking because they did not control. It was Team Afghanistan that controlled the game. And also both the goals were scored by Afghanistan. So that was a bit, in the sense was not too inspiring and not too motivated to see that India can, do well. So it was completely a mix. But I think we'll have to do much better.
Do you think India qualifying for the next FIFA, because there are 48 nations that will be available for the next time, that World Cup?
I don't see India with the current team we have, current talent we have, to really qualify for FIFA, because realistically it will be difficult.
Right. Again, coming back to, you have seen Euro, we have seen individual brilliances, you have seen team brilliances in Copa, so we are seeing Messi doing still really great for Argentina, Neymar playing well. So there is a lot of individual brilliances going around the Europe and America, and this is a great feast for football fans.
I think in South America and Copa, you'll always see individual brilliance, because the kind of football that's been played is where you see more of individual talent and a lot of individual, big names, and they actually come up to dominate the world football. So Copa America is going to be an individual brilliance kind of a tournament. It's not going to be a teamwork that will win you a lot of time. Obviously, at the end, it is teamwork, but you'll see that individual brilliance quite a lot compared to Euro. So it'll be more of a, it's not going to be like Euro, more of a team effort that goes on to win the tournament. So I won't be surprised the likes of Neymar doing magic there, Messi again doing magic. I think in Copa you'll see those kind of individual talent coming.
Alright, thank you much for doing this interview with us. And hopefully you give us time and the tournament progresses further and we get to do and talk more about football. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Please subscribe.